Okay, can you hear me? All right. I'm from Hawaii, so in Hawaii, we greet everybody with the aloha. So we're going to say that together. Anybody from Hawaii, by the way? Oh, you lived in Hawaii. Anybody visited Hawaii? Oh, okay, we have a few. All right, so we're going to bring Hawaii to you today then. So in Hawaii, when we greet each other, we say aloha. So let's do that together. Ready? One, two, three. Aloha! Yeah? Do you know what aloha means in Hawaiian? That's a Hawaiian word. Do you know what that means? Aloha means love. And actually in Hawaii, it's like the spirit of love. And where does the spirit of love come from? Or who is love? Love is God, right? Love is God, love is from God. So really the whole spirit in Hawaii is the aloha spirit, and I want to bring that to you. So I want to thank you for allowing me to come and speak today. And I just want to take some time to introduce those who are with me. So I have my three daughters back there, Rina, Anna, and Maya, and one of my judo students, Kai. And again, as Marshall was saying, we weren't planning to come down to Hiroshima. We're just going to stay up in Tokyo. And actually, we had a trip planned to go up to Tohoku. But then when my daughter said, I really want to go to Hiroshima to see the Peace Memorial, I thought, what? So we bought a rail pass. And you know, with the rail pass, you can travel anywhere on the in the JR line. And so we bought a rail pass. We came down to Hiroshima. And that's really how we got here. So I think it's God used my daughter, Maya, so that we can come here. And we're really blessed to be here because it really does feel like Hawaii. Maybe even in Hawaii, we have a little more Japanese than in this service. About 20% of them are Japanese Americans, the percentage. But it feels like a melting pot here. So when I look out, I say, oh, this feels just like Hawaii. And so I feel at home, and I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. And so what I wanted to do today is just to share with you my story and the lessons that I've learned and tie it into the Bible and encourage you along so how you can have success in your life. I think all of us want success, right? We all want to be winners. But when we think of winners and success, we sometimes think that, okay, it's only for the very talented, or the very smart, or the strong, the privileged, or the people that have money. And then we look at ourselves and we say, well, that's not me. I'll never be smart. I'll never be strong. I'm not talented, so I guess I'll just be average. But do you know that that's not the Bible? That God calls all of us to be champions for Him. And I want to share with you my story and how I became a champion, and not necessarily, as I was introduced, not the gold medalist. So even if you lose, you don't reach your goal, how God still calls us, and how through that call we can all be champions in life. All right, so I'm going to take you back a few years, 1988. I think most of you were alive at that time, right? Some of you may have been babies, and some weren't even born at that time. But it's amazing. I'm over 50 now. I look back on my life and I think, where did the past 25 years go? Don't you look, when you look back on life, it's like, wow, that was so fast. When you look forward in life, you think, wow, that's going to take forever. But when you look back, life has just gone so quickly. So I'm in that place where I'm looking back in life, and I'm looking forward in life. And it's interesting that I'm part of this group of Christian businessmen, and a lot of them are in their 60s. And 60, 65, and they're about getting time for retirement. But when they talk, they feel like they're young at heart, that life is not over, And sometimes I think when we, as we get older, we think all we're thinking about is retirement, just hitting that goal, retirement, and then I'm just going to stop. But you know the Bible doesn't talk about retirement, right? And these guys that I've talked to all the time, they say that they're so excited about life because they feel that the best is yet to come. So I believe that whatever age you are, whether you're 10 years old, 50, 60, 70, that the best is yet to come, that God has a special purpose for you, that you're not done, and He's not done. If you were done, if God was done with you, then He would take you to heaven. So the fact that you are here, living on earth today, it means God still has a purpose and a calling for you, whatever age you are. So I want to take you back to 1988, and this was in Seoul, Korea. And if you can imagine, the arena held about 7,000 people. And this is in Korea, so are there any Koreans here? Any Korean? Oh, we have one Korean, okay. But you're from, where are you from, Korea? Okay, so you're from Korea. You weren't there, you weren't in Korea in 1980? You were? Yeah, so you remember the Olympics very clearly. Or maybe you were still a little child though. Okay, in 1988, the Seoul, Korea, and the arena was filled with over 7,000 people. And there was one mat, and I was the first day of competition, the lightest weight. And I was standing there, can you imagine, standing there, and this was being broadcast, of course, all throughout Korea, and it was being broadcast in Japan and Europe and other places around the world. But this is something that I had trained for 18 years of my life. I started judo when I was 7. And I trained for 18 years. At that point, I was 25 years old. And I knew this was going to be my first and my last Olympics. So I was standing there trying to calm my fears, trying to relax. And I was praying and I was singing in my heart. And right before, a few minutes before I went up, I felt the presence of God. You know how sometimes you feel the presence of God, maybe while you're worshiping in church, and you physically sense the presence of God. Well, as I was there a few minutes just before going onto the mat, I was standing there relaxing, and I physically felt the presence of God. I felt this warmth go through my body, and all the fears and all the jitters left in an instant. And I heard a voice. It wasn't a verbal voice. I'm sorry, an audible voice, but I heard it so strongly in my heart. You know, sometimes God will speak to you that a thought comes into your heart or words come to you. And I was standing there. These words came to me so strongly. And the word said, "Kevin, you're going to do well today." Now, I immediately realized that was the Holy Spirit speaking to me. I didn't know what well meant. All the words said was, "You're going to do well today." But I was so overcome by emotion, I started to cry. You do that in church sometimes, right? When you feel the presence of God, you start to cry. But here I am in an arena filled with 7,000 people going up for my first match, and tears are coming down my eyes. And I thought, I slapped my face. I said, "Kevin, you better snap out of it, because in a few minutes, this guy next to me wants to tear my head off." But when I walked onto the mat, they called my name. I walked on. I was full of confidence. This confidence that everything was going to be well. That I was going to do well. I didn't know if that meant I was going to win or lose. But I knew that it was going to be well. As soon as I stepped onto the mat, all the Koreans there, most of them were Koreans, there, they all started to boo me. And I was surprised. Now, why in the world would the Koreans boo me? So I went through my first match. I won my match. And then I walked off. Then they called me again, my second match. And when I walked onto the mat, they booed me again. I thought, wow, what's going on? So after I won my second match, I thought to myself, I'm here. I'm not going to let anything or anyone disrupt this, what I thought to myself was a celebration. So I said, I'm going to just enjoy myself. So I waved my hands to the Koreans, to the audience, after I won my second match. Same thing happened in my third match. I walked onto the mat, they booed me. I won the match, and then I waved to the crowd. And then the fourth match, it was against the player from Japan. So this is the semifinal match. So this player was the captain of the Olympic team. He was a 1984 Olympic gold medalist. He was the world champion, and in the previous year I fought him and I lost by a decision. And so he's a very, very tough player. But as soon as we walked onto the mat, instead of booing me, the whole crowd chanted USA. So these are all the Koreans now. All the Koreans started to stomp on the ground and they chanted in unison, USA, USA. Of course, I am totally confused, right? But I thought, wow, the Koreans finally got it. They realize how good of a guy I am. So I thought, there is no way I'm going to lose to this Japanese. And we went throughout the whole match. There was no score in the match. And it came down to, after five minutes, it came down to a decision. And the referee raised, what happens in judo is that if there's no score, at least before, when there was no score, then they have a judge's decision. So there's a judge on both sides, and they're holding two flags, either a red flag or a white flag. And the competitors will either wear a red or a white sash. Now it's a little different rules, but that's what it was back at that time. So the judge raised, one judge raised the red flag for the Japanese. The other judge raised the white flag for me. And it turned out to be a split. Now the referee had to choose who he thought was who was more aggressive. And he gave me the win. And so I won by a really, really small margin. And all the Koreans went wild. They were so happy for me. And so this time I raised both hands. And it was like, it was an amazing feeling to be in that situation. And I didn't really know what was going on until after the Olympics, after talking to the Koreans and finding out what it was. And it was really a historical thing. It was really the older generation who didn't really care for the Japanese because the Japanese came in and they occupied Korea. And so the Koreans had, they wanted to show the Japanese that they could beat them at their own sport in their own country, in Korea. So when I walked onto the mat, being Japanese American with a Japanese name, they booed me. The Japanese, of course, he was Japanese, made in Japan, right? So they booed him. Both of us, when we walked onto them, they booed us. But now here we are in the finals, or in semifinals, you have a Japanese from Japan and a Japanese from America. So I think the Koreans decided that I was American at that point, so they chanted USA. And so that's how I gained the popularity at that moment. Well, we came into the finals. And there's about 190 countries in the world that do judo. So can you guess where my opponent was from? Anybody throw out a guess? You'll be one out of 190. That's the chances. But remember, we're fighting in Korea, right? So my opponent was Korean. So we come to the finals. And they call our names, so as we walk onto the mat, thank goodness that they didn't boo me, but they chanted his name. His name was Kim J. Yup. So they chanted his name in unison, stomping on the floor and shouting as loud as they could, Kim J. Yup, Kim J. Yup. I mean, it was so loud, one of the news reporters said that it sounded like they were chanting, kill that bum. Kill that bum, you know. So I was the bum and they wanted to kill me. And so that's my entrance into the finals. At that point, I realized I have all of Korea in Korea against me at that moment. So we started the competition. We went back and forth about 2 minutes. There's no score. He came in for a choke. And I grabbed his fingers to stop him from choking. And the referee gave me a penalty, a small penalty. A shido in Japanese, in judo. And I wasn't able to get past that for the rest of the match. And as soon as the match was over, the buzzer rang. And let me just show you here. Oh, what's going on? Oh, I love that. Let's go back to singing. Oh, here we go. Okay. So as soon as the buzzer rang, the Korean fell down onto his hands and knees because he had just won the Olympics, right? I mean, he was overcome with emotion. And at that moment, I was standing there in the middle of the mat, and I thought to myself, this is the end of my career. And it was like 18 years flashed before my eyes of judo when I started as a 7-year-old, growing up in high school and going to college and training. I trained at Tokai University in Kanagawa for 2 years, went to San Jose State, trained there, and then made it to the Olympics. And at that moment, I thought to myself, what does it feel like to be an Olympic champion? And I just missed it by that much. So I thought to myself, this is my last Olympics. I want to see what it feels like to be a champion. So I raised my hands just to see what it felt like to be a champion. And here's a picture of this. This is the finals after losing to the Korean. And it says, can you find the gold medalist? And it says, if you guessed Kevin Asano, you are wrong. But at that moment, and I didn't realize it at that time, I just wanted to see what it felt like to be a champion. But I realized, and God brought it to my mind, that it's not so much what happens to you that makes you successful in life, but it happens what is inside of you. And so I felt like I was a champion in my heart, because God had called me to do things. And because I was obedient, and remember, he never promised me, he didn't say, Kevin, you will win the gold medal today. He said, you're going to do well today. And because of that, I realized that God, when God calls us, it doesn't necessarily mean that we're going to be, we're going to win a gold medal, or we're going to have a lot of money, or we're going to be famous. But when we're obedient to what he calls us to do, then God looks down and he says, well done, my good and faithful servant. And so at that moment, I realized in my heart that before God, I was a champion. And I just want to share with you three things that I've learned about being a champion or having that champion spirit in life that God is looking for. And number one is to seek out. God has a call, he has a purpose, and he has a dream for all of us. Now notice I use the words, I say, seek out. I'm not saying come up with your own dream. I'm saying seek out. Find out what God has called you to do. He's put a purpose in everybody's life. Even before we were born, God put a purpose, a call in our lives. Here in Jeremiah it says that, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Now sometimes we think, I know for myself, my mind contradicts what the Word of God says. In my mind, a lot of times I think, God, I'm not good enough. Or I don't know how you could use me. I've made so many mistakes. I've sinned. I've fallen short. I've hurt other people. How in the world, God, could you use me because of who I am or what I've done? But that's not what the Word of God says. Right now, if there's a conflict, something that I'm thinking and the Bible thinks, which is truth? Is it what we think? No, it's what the Bible says. So we have to realign our thinking with what the Bible says. And the Bible says that God has a plan for our lives to prosper us and not to harm us, to give us a future and a hope. So I don't know where you are if you're thinking, oh man, I don't think I can make it through life, or is there anything good for me? We need to align ourselves with what the Bible says, because he says he's plans to give you a future and a hope. And this is something that I've often wrestled with. How am I going to know what I'm supposed to do in life? How do I know? And here's a scripture that's always been dear to my heart. This is found in Psalms 37. It says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. So what does that mean? That means that as you put God first, now it doesn't mean that you have to be perfect, because there is absolutely no way that we can be perfect. But if our heart is for God, and we want to serve God, and we want to please God, then as we do that, God is going to put desires in our heart. He's going to drop desires in our heart on things to do. And then as we have that desire, sometimes we'll think, well, maybe that's just me. But as he puts that desire, that thing, oh, maybe I'd like to do this. As he does that, then we begin to move forward, and that's when we begin to narrow down what God wants for our lives. Because at first, there's so many things we can do. But as we say, God, I don't know what it is. And you could be a high school student. You could be a young adult, or you could be like me in my middle age, and I'm still saying, God, what do you want for my life? But as we do that, God is going to put certain desires in our heart. I'll give you an example. The first time I came to Japan was in 1979. And when I came back from Japan, that was for judo. This was out in Kumamoto. And brutal August weather. And after I came back from Japan, I thought to myself, I am never going to Japan again. Never. And God worked it out that he had me come back again just a few years later. And after I spent 2 years in Japan at Tokai University, and then I was going to Japan. I actually married a woman from Japan. I couldn't find a good woman in the United States, so I figured the best place to come is Japan, right? And then we had our children, and then for about 9 years we hadn't come to Japan. And then I became the chairman of the president of the United States Judo Federation, and I just felt that this desire to come back to Japan. And that was about three years ago. This desire came up because Japan was not on my radar. I thought, well, it's going to be a while that I hadn't come back to Japan for 9 years. It's going to be a while more. There's really no reason for me to come to Japan. But then this thought, this desire, this, oh, I want to go to Japan, started coming up. And I thought, well, what am I going to do in Japan? I said, I don't know what I'm going to do in Japan, but I'm just going to go anyway. And so in the past 3 years, I think I've come about 11 times now. And so I'm wondering, okay, God, what do you have for me? Right, from not going at all, and then coming 11, I kind of lost count, 12 times. And saying, okay, God, that was just from this desire that just kind of popped up in my heart. And not knowing what to do, I just took a chance and I came. And that's number two. When God speaks to you, when you begin to find out, okay, this is what God's call for me, this is what I'm supposed to do, and you may not have the clearest picture, but then number two is you need to step out. You need to take a risk. And I know it's hard sometimes to take a risk because we think, well, what if I fail? What if I, you know, I'm not good enough? Or sometimes it's, what if I succeed? I don't know what I'm going to do if I succeed. So a lot of times we may know or have this inkling of what we're supposed to do, but because of fear, we don't step out. But what does the Bible say about fear? Hebrews 11 says, and without faith it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him. And that's what it is. That if we really want to please God, we're going to have to take some risks in life. I think the easiest, well, seemingly the easiest thing to do is just to stay at home, sit on your favorite seat, and watch TV. That's easy, right? It takes a risk if you step out of your comfort zone. It took a risk for me when I was 19 years old to leave Hawaii, to leave all my friends and family, to come to Japan, not knowing anybody. It took a risk for me to come to Japan 3 years ago. But unless we do something, we're never going to see what God can do in our lives. So is there something that God has been maybe stirring in your heart for you to do, but maybe you've just been too fearful or maybe doubting, that cannot be God? Sometimes when I look at my life, and if I get fearful about something, then I take notice, because I think, well, this might be God speaking to me. That He doesn't want us just to live in our comfort zone. That if there's something out there that He wants me to do and I begin to get fearful, I think, well, I need to face the fear head on, and I need to face it with faith. And even if we fail, if we're serving God, what does the Bible say? That He'll make all things turn to good, right? So in a sense, we really cannot fail. But here's a third thing that I think that's important. It's the idea of sticking out in perseverance. Because we can get excited about the call of God. We can step out in faith, but to walk it on the daily life is hard. I remember when I came to Japan to train at Tokai University, the first thing I realized there were about 80 players, and I was the smallest there. And every day for 2 years, I got beaten up, literally thrown and choked and armbarred and pinned. And you can handle that for about a week. But when it grinds on 6 days a week for months and years, it starts to weigh on you and you think, did I really hear God? And it was easy for me just to say, you know what, I'm going to go back to Hawaii. I'm going to go back to school. But I thought, no, God is calling me to do this, so I need to stick it out. I remember one day after practice, I was so frustrated. Because even the girls were throwing me around that day. And I went down to the locker room, and I sat down, I put my face into the towel, and I was sobbing because I was just so frustrated. It felt like I knew that God had called me to train for the Olympics, but it was like I wasn't moving forward at all. In fact, I felt like I was going backwards. But in those times, when I say stick it out, when I say persevere, I don't mean that you do it in your own strength. Because we don't have the strength to do it. It has to be a strength that comes from God. Because if we're going to be doing supernatural things, whenever God calls us to do something, it's going to require the supernatural, not just our natural abilities. And if it's the supernatural that God calls us to do, then He's the one that's going to give us the strength. So it's not, I got to grind it out, but God, give me the strength to not give up. And when we call on Him, He does that. Philippians says, being confident of this, that He who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. So again, when I say stick it out or persevere, it's the idea that calling God alongside of you to persevere. I'm a businessman. I have my own company. I do financial investing, a lot of retirement planning. And I can recall one particular season in my business career where it became so very stressful. Do you guys experience any stress in Japan? Any stress? I don't know. I come here to Hiroshima and say, wow, this is like country. No stress here, right? Or you think, oh, Hawaii, man, we're just sitting out on the beach, right? Surfing all day long. But we have stress too in Hawaii, by the way. So one particular time, it was so stressful. And I turned to my partner and I said, Dell, I don't know if I can make it through another day. And he just stopped. And he says, Kevin, let's pray. So we're in our room. We sat next, we faced each other. And he began to pray for me. And I felt the burden lift off of me. And I felt this hope and this strength come back to me saying that I'm going to make it through this. And of course I made it through. That was like 10 years ago, maybe 12 years ago. And it was a supernatural thing. That just that prayer gave me the hope that I'm going to make it through. We're going to do that. And I think that's one of the keys to success. If we're going to do this, we can't do it alone. We have to have other people. And that's why it's so important to come to church. I have a group of men. We call them a band of brothers in our church, and it's a small group. Every Thursday we get together and we process life. And so if someone is struggling, they'll share and we'll give our input, we'll encourage them, we'll pray for them. And we've become very close. And I realized that life is difficult. Living a Christian life is difficult. Most of you, I guess, are foreigners like myself. I know what it's like to be in Japan in another culture, and it is even more difficult. And that's why so much more so we need one another. We need people who are besides a band of brothers, who will stick with us in any situation, who will be there to pray for us and to encourage us. So as we do that, so as we come to the understanding where if we're going to be successful in life, God has called us to be successful. There's three things again that I found that is important is to discover God's call for our lives. Number two is to step out and take the faith, take risk on what God is calling us to do. Of course, we want to get counsel from our friends and our pastors. And number three is with the strength of God to persevere through the difficulty. And if you do that, just like myself, when I was standing there, I lost at the Olympics. But I realized, yes, that's what I did. God, you called me to this judo. I stepped out and I did it. You helped me through the most difficult times. And so, yes, I can stand in the middle of the whole world and raise my hands and look like a fool, probably. Like, didn't he know he just lost, that idiot? But stand before God and say, God, before you, I'm a champion. And I believe that that's what God is calling all of us to do. Now, I imagine none of you, or maybe one of my daughters will go to the Olympics one day, but none of you probably will not go to the Olympics, but whatever God has called you, you can be a champion in that area. So I just wanted to leave that and hope that encourages you. And I'm just going to give you one more story. I'll leave this with you. What is your dream? So I'm going to ask you, what is your dream? What has God called you to do? Now, I'm asking God that myself right now. And I've been thinking, I got to put this on paper, these thoughts that are in my mind. But you know what? I'm hesitant to put it down on paper because I'm thinking to myself, I don't see how this is possible. So it's kind of like if I don't put it down in paper, then I don't have to face my fear. But I'm realizing that I need to step out. God's putting something in my heart. I need to write that down. And I need to step out. And even how impossible I feel it is, it's not going to happen in my own strength. It's going to happen with God. And if God wants it to happen, He will make it happen in a supernatural way. So I want to encourage you, what is your dream? What is God calling you to do? Take that first step. Write it down. Share it with somebody. And then if there's that green light, go. Persevere. And allow God to make you into a champion as well. Amen? All right, let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you, God, that you are a God that has great plans for us, that you want us to prosper, that you want us to be the head and not the tail, that you want us to be a light on the hill, the salt of the earth in a dark generation. So Father, I pray that you will begin to speak to people, to each one here. Lord, that they will ask, God, what do you want me to do? And as they ask, Lord, that you will reveal to them. And Father, those who know what they're supposed to do, but maybe a little fearful, that you will give them the faith to step out, to take that step and go forward. And Lord, for those who are going forward, but sometimes they think, this is weary, this is tiring, I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I can go on another day. Lord, that you will come and that you will strengthen them. That you will bring the people around them, godly people who will be there to encourage them, to pray with them. And Lord, that you will guide and lead them. And Father, so that at the end of our life, at the end of our mission, that we can look back and that we can hear the words, well done, my good and faithful servant. So I thank you, God. Help us all to be the champions that you've called us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.